Hello, my friends. Brian DeVerse here from IXRF Systems. I'm in our lab in Austin, Texas, to speak with my friend and our general manager, Mandy Hellestead. Mandy is excellent. She is one of our resident scientists here, and she's got a great deal of knowledge on microscopy as well as atomic spectroscopy. Mandy, people have been using SEM for a long time now, right? And there's this approach, however, of getting a little bit more information by using EDS. Can you please let us know what is EDS and how are people using it?
Sure. So first, let's start, what the heck is EDS? Ready for a mouthful. Energy Dispersive Spectroscopy. So really what that means is it allows us to get elemental information from our samples. So having an electron microscope, we get these great images, but they're just images. So by adding EDS, we can actually get elemental information from our samples. Not only what's in our samples, but where is it located? So spatial variation within the material can be collected through what we call mapping.
Okay, so elemental analysis by EDS, right? So what elements can we see with this technology?
That's always a tricky question. The short answer is almost all of them. I know that sounds aggressive. So we can see essentially from beryllium up to uranium, but what we can see is always very much dependent on what's in your sample, what elements are present, and what else is in there, what we would call matrix.
So EDS technology appears to be a great technology for a qualitative analysis. And when you're looking at your materials, what can we do about quantitative analysis? Is it possible to measure elemental concentration with EDS?
Yeah, absolutely. One thing we can do that's very useful is comparative. So I can say sample A has more and sample B has less, because we can compare those, you know, the peak heights in our samples. But to get to full quantitation, that's where we're looking for those concentrations. And we are limited a little bit. EDS, even under the best circumstances, is considered semi-quantitative, even if we have access to standards. And part of that is because our limit of detection. So depending on your matrix, depending on your element, our limit of detection is about 1,000 parts per million. So it's really hard to call that fully quantitative if I can't split hairs and tell the difference between, say, 3.1% and 3.2%.
So how can someone that is using an SEM microscope with an EDS get even more from their system?
That's a great question. So with your normal EDS system, you're using the electron beam of your SEM to get your elements. But what we can do is add XRF to the SEM. So you may have heard of other techniques like benchtop XRF or handheld XRF. So we can take the power of XRF and add it to our SEM. So what does that do for us? That actually gives us a lot more information. With your E-beam, you're only able to get certain elements, certain peaks. With your XRF, we're adding some more power in that we're able to get some of our heavier elements. We're able to resolve peak overlaps. And later we can talk about how and why that happens with the XRF. But also with XRF, we're actually able to see trace levels of elements that we're not able to see on EDS.
All right, so then why should I consider adding an XRF source to my SEM?
Sure, so let's say you have a sample and you're analyzing with EDS. Then maybe you hit it with XRF. You might realize that there are five elements in your sample you had no idea were present because they're below the limits of detection of your EDS. We see this a lot in glass. So a perfect example is the NIST 610 glass. If you hit it with your E-beam, we're seeing about five elements, what you would expect in glass, your calcium and your silicon. But then if you hit it with XRF, there's about 15 elements that we had no idea were present when we were looking at the EDS spectrum. And that's a detection limit issue. With the XRF, we're able to see all those elements that are in that glass that are about 200 to 600 ppm, well below the limit of detection for EDS. Also, elemental overlaps. If we think of some of our heavier elements, with EDS, we're stuck having to try to identify multiple heavy elements in the lower energy region where they all overlap and sit on top of each other. But with XRF, we have much higher energy. We can actually excite those heavier elements at the higher end of the energy spectrum and get really nice peaks and have confidence in identifying those elements are indeed present and not being stuck sitting trying to figure out this blob of peak at the lower energy. Perfect example would be molybdenum, lead, and sulfur. Low energy, big blob, but if we hit it with XRF, we can easily form and see those lead and molybdenum peaks. So now we know for sure we have those elements in our sample.
I can certainly see some of the advantages from a qualitative perspective of what an XRF source can do for you and adding one to your SEM. But is this also true from a quantitative perspective?
Sure, it's actually much better. If we have access to standards, we can really dive deep with quantitation with XRF. Earlier we talked about with EDS, we're limited for quantitation according to our limit of detection. We're at about 1,000 parts per million. So it really limits how good our quant can be. With XRF, again, matrix and element dependent, we're able to get down into hundreds of ppms, maybe 10 ppms for your elements. So with proper standards, we can really dive deep on quant.
I can see that having good quality standards is good for building an empirical calibration, but what if you don't have access to standards? Can you still do quantitative analysis?
That's okay too. We have incredibly powerful software that can actually do standardless quantitation. So what the software is going to do is it's going to look at the elements in your spectrum. It's going to take into account what energy they were collected at. It's going to take into account inter-elemental effects, essentially a lot of fancy math. But what that math is going to do is going to give you standardless quantitation. It's going to give you really good results according to what's in your material.
So then what is required to add an XRF source to your SEM?
Sure. So what we need is an open port, a place where we can just put on that XRF source. A WDS port is best, or a high angle port. You know, it's nice to have that big space on the side of the scope. We can work with other ports, but high angle is best.
It sounds like analysis with SEM-EDS can really benefit and be enhanced by adding an XRF source. So how does someone get started?
Just reach out to us. We'll give you our website and the right email to reach out to. And we're going to talk to you about what microscope you have. And we'll ask you some questions about what available ports. We may even ask for a few photos just around your column so we can see what you got on there. And then we can figure out how to help you.